गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, इन दिस लेक्चर नंबर 14 ऑफ क्वांटम मैकेनिक्स वी विल डिस्कस जीपी थॉमसन एक्सपेरिमेंट। एज इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड डेविसन एंड जर्मर एक्सपेरिमेंट विच प्रूव्ड द एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ मैटर वेव्स। सिमिलरली जीपी थॉमसन एक्सपेरिमेंट, इट इज ऑल्सो द एक्सपेरिमेंट विच विल एक्सपेरिमेंटली prove the existence of matter waves, that is de Broglie waves. So in this G.P. Thomson experiment, Thomson accelerated the electrons from 10,000 to 50,000 volts. And after accelerating the electrons to such a high voltage, what did he observe? He observed the diffraction pattern which was exactly similar to that of diffraction pattern of X-rays. And we know that X-rays are waves. So if X-rays behave like waves and the diffraction pattern in case of electrons, it is similar, exactly similar to that of diffraction pattern obtained in the case of X-rays. Therefore, we can conclude that electrons also behave like waves, that is de Broglie wave is associated with the motion of electrons. So in this experiment he used cathode C with the help of which high energy electron beam is produced. This cathode C, it will produce high energy electron beam. Then from this cathode and this lid, the potential, it is increasing from 10,000 volts to 50,000 volts. It means after the production of electron beam, high energy electron beam from this cathode, the electron beam will be further accelerated to the potential difference of 50,000 volts. Then there is a slit. So this highly energetic accelerated electron beam, it will pass through this slit and it will get converted into a fine beam, that is collimated beam, which means directional beam. And then this highly energetic directional electron beam, it is made to fall on the thin gold foil or aluminium foil. And then after passing through the foil, we observe the diffraction pattern which was similar to that of the diffraction pattern of X-rays on this photographic plate, and the concentric rings were observed. First there was central maxima, then first minima, then first maxima, then again this white portion, it is minima, then this black one, it is first maxima, then again minima, second maxima, then again minima, then third maxima. But the intensity of maximas, it will decrease, because in case of diffraction, intensity, it decreases as the order of diffraction increases. First order diffraction, second order, third order, and so on. And this whole setup, it is placed in this highly evacuated discharge tube, that is vacuum is maintained inside this tube to ensure that this highly energetic electron beam, it may not lose its energy after the collision with molecules, air molecules inside this discharge tube. Next thing was, because there is also possibility that when these electron beam, the beam of these electrons, highly energetic electrons, when it is passing through the foil, there is possibility of the production of X-rays by this electron beam. When this electron beam, it gets collided with the atoms of the thin gold foil, so there is chance that the final diffraction pattern, it is produced by the X-rays, which are produced by the electron beam while passing through the thin gold foil. So to ensure this, that this diffraction pattern, it is because of the electron beam and not because of the x-rays produced, they used magnetic field. Thomson used magnetic field. Why he used magnetic field? Because we know that electron beam is the charged beam, so it will get deflected by the magnetic field. So if the final diffraction pattern, if it is because of electrons, then the electron beam, it will be deflected by the magnetic field. But if the final diffraction pattern, if it will be produced by the x-rays, and we know that x-rays are neutral, uncharged, so they will not be affected by the magnetic field. So what he observed was that there was deflection in the direction of electron beam under the effect of magnetic field, which ensure that the final diffraction pattern is because of the electron beam and not because of the x-rays. So Thomson concluded that electrons behave like a wave, because in this diffraction pattern we observed the concentric rings in the same way as that of the x-ray diffraction pattern. So this was all about G.P. Thomson experiment, which also confirmed the existence of de Broglie waves associated with a motion of material particle. Next topic is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Now, because according to de Broglie hypothesis, he assumed that a wave, it is associated with every moving material particle. So just because of the discovery of this wave nature of matter, now it was difficult to define the word particle. According to classical mechanics, where we deal with the motion of macroscopic bodies, the position and the momentum of the macroscopic bodies, it can be determined simultaneously as well as accurately at every instant of time. But it is done classically. In case of quantum mechanics, where we deal with microscopic bodies as well as macroscopic bodies, but in quantum mechanics we mostly deal with microscopic bodies. In classical mechanics we deal with macroscopic bodies. That's why it is easier to determine position and momentum of macroscopic bodies simultaneously as well as accurately in case of classical mechanics. But in case of quantum mechanics, because we deal with microscopic particles, and Schrödinger just postulated that instead of a single wave, a group of waves is associated with the motion of moving particle. So we cannot measure the exact position and momentum of a particle simultaneously and accurately. It means because wave packet, it can be anywhere inside the wave packet. It has some distance, some length, that is delta x. The length of the wave packet, suppose it is delta x. It means particle can be somewhere inside this wave packet of length delta x. So there is always uncertainty in the position of the particle. So if we cannot just predict the position of the particle exactly, that what is the exact position of the particle, it means there will always be some uncertainty in the position of the particle, because it can be somewhere inside the wave packet. And if there is uncertainty in its position, then there will be uncertainty in its velocity. And we know that momentum, it is mass into velocity. So there will be definite uncertainty in its momentum also. So Heisenberg states that this uncertainty principle, according to this uncertainty principle, the exact position and the momentum of a microscopic particle, it cannot be determined simultaneously and accurately. So according to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, there will always be uncertainty in the position as well as in the momentum of the particle. So according to this, if delta x is the uncertainty in the position of the particle and delta p is the uncertainty in the momentum of the particle, then the product of these two uncertainties will always be greater than this h by 2 pi, means h cut. So there will be always some value of uncertainty. So now we will prove this Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So to prove this Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, we will use the concept of de Broglie waves, that is matter waves, and wave packet. So the simplest case of considering the wave packet is the combination of two waves. So here we have considered a wave packet which is obtained from the combination of two waves having same amplitude but different angular velocity by delta omega and different wave number by delta q. So what will be the equation of displacement of the two waves? It will be y1 is a cos omega t minus kx and y2 will be a cos omega plus delta omega t minus k plus delta kx. Now these two waves, they will superimpose upon each other, and after superposition what we will get? The displacement of the wave packet, which will be the sum of this y1 and y2. And we have already solved this y1 plus y2 for the article of group velocity. So here I have written the direct expression after using the formula of cos c plus cos d. And suppose this as equation number 1. And this equation, as you can clearly see, this part, it represents the harmonic part, and this part, it represents the amplitude of the modulated wave packet or modulated group of waves. As you can clearly see, here the amplitude was constant, amplitude of the wave. But in this case, as this amplitude A, 2A, it gets multiplied with this part delta omega by 2 into t and minus delta k by 2 into x. And this t and x, they are variable. So this whole cos part, it is variable. It implies that amplitude will be variable in case of modulated group of waves. So the wave packet, it will be like this. As you can clearly see that this portion, it defines the cosine part, and this portion, it shows the that there is variation in the amplitude of the wave packet. And this wave packet, it is having group velocity, that is d omega by dk. Here we are writing that group velocity as delta omega by delta k. So you can also write this delta omega by delta k as d omega by dk. So now we know that in this wave packet, particle can be anywhere inside this wave packet. So there will always be uncertainty in finding the exact position of the particle. But we know that it will lie somewhere inside this. And these two points, these are the consecutive nodes of the wave packet. Nodes are the points where the amplitude becomes zero. So as you can clearly see that at these two points, the amplitude of the wave packet, it is zero. So these two points are nodes. Suppose this is at position x1 and this node, it is at position x2, and this delta x is the length of the wave packet. So we know that particle, it lies between these two consecutive nodes, x1 and x2. And nodes are the points where amplitude, it becomes zero. But what is the value of amplitude? Amplitude of wave packet, it is given by this 2a cos delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2 x. And we know that at nodes amplitude, it is equal to 0. Now this 2a, 0 divided by 2a will be 0. So this implies we have cos delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2x, it is equal to 0. And we know that the value of cos, it is 0 at pi by 2, 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2 and so on up to 2n plus 1 pi by 2. So this implies this delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2x, it will be equal to either pi by 2 or 3 by pi 2 or 5 pi by 2 up to so on 2n plus 1 pi by 2. Now this is the equation, general equation will be, so this will be the general equation which will be satisfied by the nodes. As suppose this as equation 2, now as x1 and x2 are the consecutive nodes, are consecutive nodes, so these two nodes, they will satisfy this equation number 2. Therefore, for x is equal to x1, equation 2 will become delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2 x1. It will be equal to 2n plus 1 pi by 2. And then the next consecutive node, that is for x is equal to x2, this equation 2 will become delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2 x2, it is equal to, because the two nodes are consecutive. If this node is corresponding to n is equal to n, then the next node, it will be n plus 1th node. So here this n will be n plus 1. So we have 2n plus 2 plus 1, that is 2n plus 3 pi by 2. Delta omega by 2t minus delta k by 2 x by 2. This 2 will be cancelled out and we have this equation, delta omega t minus delta k x2, it is equal to 2n plus 3 pi. And suppose this is equation 4th, similarly here this 2, it will be cancelled out and we have equation delta omega t minus delta k x1, it is equal to 2n plus 1 pi. Suppose this is our equation 3rd. Next is, subtract equation 3rd from equation 4th. Subtract equation 3rd from equation 4th. What we will get? This delta omega t, it will be cancelled out. We are subtracting this equation from this. It means this minus this. So minus and minus, it will become plus. And this delta k, it will be common. So delta k is common. What is left behind is x1 minus x2. It is equal to right hand side of 4th minus right hand side of 3rd. And we will get 2 pi. So we have the value of x1 minus x2, that is the difference between the two consecutive nodes. It is 2 pi by delta k. And this difference, it will define the uncertainty in the position of the particle. Higher this distance will be, higher will be the uncertainty in the position of the particle. Smaller is the distance between x1 and x2, smaller will be the uncertainty in the position of the particle. So this x1 minus x2, it will tell us about the uncertainty in the position of the particle. It is 2 pi by delta k. Suppose this as equation 5th. suppose this as equation 5th. Now we have to calculate the value of delta k in terms of delta p, because we need the final expression delta x into delta p. So delta x is already there in equation 5th, and now we need to convert this delta k into delta p. And we know that k, it is 2 pi by lambda, and as we are discussing about de Broglie wave, this de Broglie wavelength, it is h by p. So what will be the value of delta k? So delta k will be 2 pi by h into delta p. Now put this value of delta k in this equation 5th. So put this, it will be delta x is equal to 2 pi upon value of delta k is 2 pi by h into delta p. This 2 pi and 2 pi, it will be cancelled out, and move this h to the numerator and move this delta p to left hand side. So we will get this, which is the required expression of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, which implies that the product of uncertainty in position and momentum of the particle, it is always greater than h cut. So this is the proof of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. And there is also another form of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, which is known as energy time uncertainty principle. So there is another form of uncertainty principle, so another form is energy time uncertainty principle. So according to this form, the product of uncertainty in energy and uncertainty in time, it is greater than equal to h cut. So according to this energy time uncertainty principle, the exact energy and exact time of the moving particle cannot be measured or determined simultaneously and accurately. So now we have to prove this from this. So how we will prove? Suppose that moving particle is having mass m and velocity v, then it will have some kinetic energy. So then kinetic energy of that moving particle, it will be given by E is equal to half m v square. And according to this uncertainty principle, we need to find the expression for delta E. So what will be the value of delta E? It will be delta of half m v square. Delta means here differentiation. So it will be half is constant, m is constant. Differentiation of v square will be 2v delta v. This and 2 and 2, it will be cancelled out. And you can write this as v into delta of mv, because m is constant. You can write it as mdv or d of mv. And this mv, it is equal to p. So we have v into delta p. So our energy delta e, it comes out to be v into delta p. And we know that velocity is displacement upon time. So velocity is delta x by delta t. Means velocity is dx by dt. So you can also write it as delta x by dt. Now move this delta t to this side, and we have that this delta e into delta t, it is equal to delta x into delta p, and which is equal to greater than equal to h cut. So this is energy time uncertainty principle, which is the another form of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So this is also proved. So in the next lecture, we will discuss about most important applications of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. There are various applications of this principle, which we'll discuss in the next lecture.